Jake. Jake and I know each other for years. I used to live in Western Massachusetts for years, so it's still looks like you're my kids. Okay, but I'm here to check it out. Love yours. The duo you've never filled mate. XL4,
yeah, trio with contracts.
And contracts, yes, right. That's right. Two of your two percussions. I mention that because you yourself are a percussionist, and I'd like to know more about your introduction as a percussionist to the work of Professor Graves. I know that you studied with him. And I was curious when you went into those studies if you had much brief history of with him, just knowing what you knew about him as a musician.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's like interesting to just find some question for him in that context between the environment of Western Mass, what I grew up in, the reading that so. Influential and kind of provided the access to information that I'm not sure I necessarily would have run into anywhere else. So once I grew up in Springfield, actually, about 20 minutes
out of that,
Springfield, Massachusetts, yeah, kind of an industrial city, bigger city, about 20 minutes out of Northampton. And my friends and I. My friend Khalid, his dad had some records, had some Ornicola records. We kind of like skip school in high school, listen to records, get high, and then we started buying records, and you could only buy those kind of records in Northampton. So by the time I was 16, we were driving up to Northampton. This was in 1992, 93. Right around the time Michael Adler's was starting to do Fire in the Valley and present artists that were playing at the Vision Festival in New York City. So it was like a very small town. Mm-hmm. But we were able to see Marshall Allen from Sun Ra headline and the next day see you improvising with games from just like being young and kind of driving up 91 and kind of meeting people who worked at the record stores, meeting people who worked at the video stores who were all kind of interested to help me and my high school friends understand things better. It was like a kind of situation where if I was there to buy an Ornicola record, someone would hit me to an Allen record.
It's interesting because in the bank, right, it's at the end, there's two factions going on. There's the Graves family.
Yeah.
And then there's all these, this whole community in Western Massachusetts.
Right.
But Northampton, Massachusetts is 3 hours north of New York City. And it's a bit of a community. It's five universities there. It's Amherst College, it's University of Massachusetts, it's Holyoke University. So it's sort of a thriving community of academics. But also, it has an old school of Yankee kind of farmer history as well. So it's a good dynamic. If you're talking about going to record stores and to concerts in this area, it was pretty amazing, and still is. You have Brian Coley's name on your credits, and he's somebody who's always been very important as far as disseminating a lot of music history through recording. He's one of the foremost kind of avant-garde jazz record collectors in the world, and he's living in that community, and he has a record store, and he sort of made sure that it's like you sort of discovered this music.
Yeah.
But did you have much of an interest in avant-garde jazz at this time in your youth, or was it something you were just discovering right now? I mean, what were you coming out of?
Yeah, so I was the drummer. I grew up playing drums. I grew up, my dad was a classical musician for Springfield Symphony, and I'm very strict on practice. And I started on cello and disappointed him that way, and trumpet at this point, but that way. And then I finally found an instrument that he really didn't want me to play at all when I was around 10. And that's when I started drumming, but I was really fortunate in that, you know, some of the teachers I had early were pretty freaky people, like the first chair percussionist at Springfield Symphony, Michael Carr's, had a small apartment near my dad's apartment, and it was just filled with marimbas and symphony, and he was much more interested in kind of my own compositions than he was in, like, teaching rudiments. So I had access to kind of teachers that were creative, but, you know, in that journey from, you know, so I was listening to jazz, playing in the high school jazz band at the Springfield Central High School, and getting exposed to records by just becoming interested in recorded music history. And a couple of friends and I just started kind of going, and you quickly discover not only at the record stores, but also with, like, Fire in the Valley, where you see Pest play, and you start to hear Milford Graves' name, you know, where Love Cry, he's on Love Cry, like, he's still playing, and then we made our way down to a Vision Fest and saw Milford and the Ziara students kind of enter and how much the room changed. So I got to see Milford play. First time I saw him play was up at UMass, again in that same area of Western Massachusetts. But this was 2002, he played solo. It was like they were presenting solo duos, Magic Triangles. It was like Sonny Murray, Milford Graves, and I forget who the third solo percussionist was. But it might have been Rashid Ali, yeah, which is kind of interesting because there were some times in the 60s where that both three were supposed to get together. But I was totally blown away. You know, I'd already been exposed to the music on record. Percussion Ensemble was the first record I heard. It was really captivating and interesting to me because one of the drum teachers I had them basically taught me the way he learned, which is to set up speakers behind your ears while you play. So you set up a stereo system here and you just put on records and play. And so I was playing to records. I was playing to, like, you know, the alto bunch and playing along, kind of learning up to that point, you know, to copy. There was something about the Percussion Ensemble record, which is the Yara still photos, which has that music playing in the background. It's called Milford Graves Percussion Ensemble. It's Milford Graves and another drummer named Sonny Morgan. And something about that music playing along with it was so expansive and kind of invited. It really awoke in me at a pretty young age, like 17, 18 years old, like an invitation to improvise, to, like, spontaneously compose. I wasn't drawn to try to figure out. I wanted to, like, play with the record. And with the Bennington College. Well, no, I didn't. I went to Springfield Technical Community College for a little while, and then I went to University of Massachusetts, but
I was over
at Bennington. So what happened was I saw this show at UMass, and I just decided I was going to study with Milford somehow. So I went up to Bennington and kind of waited for him to show up, and, you know, he showed up, and I was down here to be a student. I wasn't a matriculated student, I just go there. I was super nervous, and kind of looked me up and down, and, like, invited me in to the studio, where there was, like, a piano and a drum set, and he told me to sit down on the drum set and said, we'll see what the story is. And I played exactly for, like, an hour, him on piano, and me on his drum kit, and it was, like, you know, I hadn't got there yet, but it was so far beyond, like, my wildest. You know my friends too, like Bill, right, and John, and everyone. You know, I was like, I'm going to do this. I'm going to go to study with Professor Graves, and the experience of how curious he was about who I was, kind of like, as you would say, like, well, you know, once you have the vibrating inside. This was 2004, and within a week, he asked me to become his assistant. He needed an assistant. He was there for like 24 hours a week teaching three classes, but they needed someone to teach the intro to percussion classes and kind of do the heartbeat recordings when he wasn't there. We kind of do intro assistantship kind of stuff. So that turned into my job, which eventually did turn into a degree, but it was all kind of through Professor Graves. So I stayed up there until he left. I think that was 2011
or 2012. When did you start to have an idea that you wanted to make a documentary film about Professor Graves?
Yeah, it's a hard question to answer because I think I've been like really interested in music films. I don't think I started recording the professor thinking that it was going to turn into a music film, but in hindsight, it all feels like part of the same wave.
When you say record, you mean actually video documentary?
Video, or actually the first recordings, like the earliest recordings that you hear that actually made it into the film are actually from way back in 2004. Just audio recordings. I was recording on minidisc, I was recording on like tape recorder. Kind of that tape, this was like as technology was changing. So I think at first the instincts were more about like, I was having these private one-on-one lessons with him after all the students were gone. This was like Tuesday night from 10 p.m. to like, could go till 2, 3 a.m. You know, just talking and learning. And I could tell, you know, I needed time to process some of the stuff that was going on, so I asked if I could record, and he granted me permission to record. That kind of started getting put on hard drive. Kind of felt like almost like an archive was building, so I kind of I thought about it that way for a while. I invited different people to come to film and do kind of interviews. There were times, so the film kind of was morphing and taking different shapes. There were times when he had like a lecture at Harvard and 2008 asked me to put together a garden scene, and that scene that I put together back then became the foundations for what became the garden scene in the film. So there was all these kind of there's all this material on hard drives, but it wasn't really until he started giving me archival material that I could really start to see like a feature length film. That's kind of an interesting part of the whole process. Was like there wasn't like a research period of like let me go find all the archival stuff that's out there. Like everything that's archival in the film were things he gave me personally, except for the footage from Middelheim Festival in Belgium, which he told me to find. They were open for Carmen McRae. It was the first European tour, so it's the same Bobby Berg except without Arthur Doyle. And he basically said this is a representation of what we were doing back then. It's pretty much undocumented. So once I saw the footage of the School for Autism, which is like an 18-minute, 16-minute video that we watched in the basement on like a 105-degree kind of New York City summer day, but projected on a wall, and I brought down a Super 8 projector from where I live, struck it up, and he showed me that, and the footage of him demonstrating Yara in the bamboo forest that's early in the film, during the planting story. And once I saw that, the film, at least in my own mind, the way I kind of remember it, the film started speaking. It was like, it started asking me
the film has a lot of patience, and I can't hear him. It seems to me that the unique thing about this film where there's a lot of respect for the idea of somebody who's in a very sort of personalized meditation model. So the film has a sort of real meditational model to it. It allows a lot of patience with that idea of meditation. I don't think I've ever seen in a music documentary. Music documentaries are generally sort of regulated by time constraints, and so the tools, it's kind of hyper editing right now, where you never get a sense of the full musicality of the artist, but sort of get a sense of their kind of personal historical value. And so it really struck me in a film where you sort of allow that, these long moments of meditation with nature going on. And I was wondering if that was something that you felt a little at odds with, like maybe you should. Because you probably have so much more information that you could put in this film. different historical films, which I'm sure are out there. So it's curious about that aesthetic.
Yeah, I mean, there's quite a lot to say on that. I think, you know, the basic thing I would say is that, you know, I am an open student, and I was a student for, you know, 15 years of the Mantis materials that I've been putting together, and I think my studentship and the lessons that were most transformative to me, they make up the content of the film, but they also influence the form of the film, the real formal aspect. So I think you could analyze the film in terms of Milford's ideas about sympathetic and parasympathetic nervous system. I think you could analyze the film through the idea of polygram. Those are the things I was thinking about as I was editing. Milford always talks about this with improvising of like, and, you know, tracking your own body sensation for when the kind of parasympathetic, the tiger response is at its peak, and then finding a way to activate the sympathetic nervous system at its peak, and find a way to activate the parasympathetic nervous system. So, that plays out in like the compositional structure.
Right.
And then I also, I think one of the things about a thinker like Milford is the way his mind works is he's making connections in a really dynamic way with a lot of different material, and that can feel overwhelming at times. So it felt like the film, it would be generous of the film to allow some of those teachings to occur and be embedded inside a situation where you're able to explore a sense of place,
right.
And a sense of I love with music and when you do have time to sense your own body in the theater, in the space, so that you can kind of track what's happening with you. And I agree. I think cinema does this really well, but for some reason, music films seem to be driven by a need to do an encyclopedic kind of narrative.
I don't find it pressuring in those music documentaries where somebody's talking about the good work and value of a particular artist, but they never really can show like a full spectrum of that artist's work. So you'll feel like tidbits of music because you can't. It's almost kind of like material, both songs. And it sort of presupposes that the viewership knows it's all. But it's not necessarily the case. So I really appreciated this when I could see, like, actually, we spent a lot of time with Milford exacting his music on screen. And his own storytelling, because it's all about storytelling.
I would say, yeah, musically and with words, like there's no words in the first 15 minutes, but the first time you see him drum, he's playing variations off of the La La Pole, the iconic and classical rhythm from the African diaspora and the Caribbean, and it's telling a story that way. So I wanted to introduce that sense of storytelling in a way that's both physical and driven by words, so that, and at times the drums are telling the story of the film, and at times he's telling the story, and sometimes they come together, but that's another way I think you can analyze the film that way. Those two elements of storytelling are kind of dancing with each other, making space for each other. One moves out of the way as the other one takes its foreground. At times they both become intense. But that was definitely done, you know, in a conscious way. And I think the thing is like Milford has this rare quality where he's an artist that's deeply engaged in a kind of a daily practice, a very just like a creative process that's omnipresent and strong in his life. And he's compelled to share some of those deeper secrets of the way his vision of drumming and rhythm. And so you have 90 minutes, and it's kind of like, you know, if you had the chance to go back in time, and, you know, would you want to film about, like, you know, Leonardo da Vinci, where it was like a chronicle of his major life achievements, or would you want to spend time in the studio looking through notebooks and understanding his concept of why and how he's putting together his art? And it seemed like the film more and more, you know, there were cuts that had, you know, there weren't really cuts of talking heads. That was actually an early thing with the music. I do feel like there's something about learning the way a teacher teaches, or learning the way someone speaks, that in 90 minutes, it's almost like you have time to actually really understand how the person is presenting their work. But there were cuts that went in different directions and had eventually the film just kind of shed in the process of the film, and it would kind of shed things that were unnecessary to, like, this idea of,
I mean, I guess it would have been really, it would have been very clear, you know, the family, you know, what other musicians have said, you know, like Mark or Charles Gale, or,
yeah, I think there's like 1,000 films you can look at. I don't know how many someone does that.
I'd like to know more about you have to do with your first film. That's a film like your end. Is it something that you feel like you want to continue exploring? Because, I mean, it's commendable work. And I know you did it, and you give really young a production of it. I'm curious about that relationship that you have with Mary Ellen and how you work together on this.
Yeah, you're also a great collaborator. You know, I have hard drives and material, and
was he there from the get-go, or
no,
no.
Neil's been involved for, like, the last 2 years of the project, just, like, 3 years now. And, you know, I had hard drives of archival, and just, Milford has some shows, the Brandeis show, actually, coming up, and I was like, I need to shoot this, with professional equipment. So I asked Neil to come down and get a 2-camera shoot, and then I looked at his footage, and it was footage of the angle that the film ends with.
Right.
And he had, like, a screenshot of just Milford's head while he was playing. Right. And I was like, oh, this stuff's really singing. So I was kind of like, you know, hop in on this. So they were both drummers, I think, you know, come from that kind of ethos of, I think we both, you know, thought about it like a band, kind of, those last couple of shoots. And then he hopped in on the editing process too. We would set up two laptops and edit together, and kind of, you know, talk about things and stuff like that.
Milford, was he involved in any of the process?
Milford. Yeah, Milford's been asked this question a couple of times, and what he's answered and what he said to me is just, I want you to surprise me. So, you know, one thing I'll say is I did see other documentaries come through during the time. I was around the house, like, I've been around the house during, you know, summers and stuff for 40, 15 years. So there's times when a New York Times article will pop up and then filmmakers would kind of appear because, you know, it's charismatic, and they would come, and then I would see some of the cuts that were made, and they just seemed so off, you know, like, so off base and so strange that, and so kind of, it just didn't seem to be about that person that I knew, so, and none of them ever really culminated either, so, I think at a certain point, you know, those last couple of years, professor was essentially just being full creative license. I didn't show him a cut until I had pretty much the final cut, and I drove it down myself, and I watched it with Milford and his wife in the dojo. And he basically turned to me when it was over and said, well, that's me up there on the screen, man. That's what I do.
That's all you needed.
That's all I needed, yeah. I mean, and since then, we've had opportunities to talk back, for him to talk more at length about the way he, what he feels about the film itself. But,
Milford lives in Queens, New York. And I figured the film is the availability of the film to be viewed by more of his community down as opposed to.
So there was this period where it was festivals, now this is representing the beginning of theatrical, they call it theatrical release, but it's played in cinemas. That's happened in the States too, so it played for 3 weeks at the Metrograph on the Lower East Side. It played in Harlem at the Maple Cinema. That screening was pretty amazing. It sold out on both floors, and a bunch of people from Milford's past, that there was people in the audience that stood up and said they hadn't seen him since he was 11 years old, and had heard about it, and then we're planning a screening, but another screening, another New York City screening coming up, and then, there's some ideas, about doing some screenings in Milford's, dojo, for the community. He screened it before it was out for all the people who were in it, in the martial arts section. And then eventually it'll be accessible online by early 2019. But now that it has a platform and it has some ways to kind of not die on the vine, that as I see some happens to some films, it's a lot more free. Milford has a sculpture exhibition at the Queens Museum, which is in the Old World's fair. That's in October, and it's sculpture, but we're also preparing archival footage and video loops and stuff for that, and there may be a screening there. That's gonna, they have field trips. Students from New York City have access to that museum for free. It's a great museum. At this point on is going to be made to just provide the most amount of access for the most amount of people to the film.
So, I imagine, in your research, just outside of the institution of the work, you mentioned also a lot of historical images.
Hopefully this opens the door to that. I think it's like I had to make the film my way. Otherwise it wouldn't work. So the film is what is not in it. In many ways, and I feel like this. That's the hope. And I'm working on other projects with him that explore elements of this film in deeper ways. I was tracking it for cinema always. I've always imagined this film playing in a theater. So it needed to to have that. You know, to me, it was the only other process I can relate it to is making music, because that's my experience, and I come from improvising and composing things in kind of an emergent way, and there is that same sense of, like, you play and you have all these ideas and things that you've worked on and things you know you're interested in, but in the dynamic space of that particular show, you kind of have to honor the material that emerges, and that ultimately is what gives it its strength and power, is that it's coming through you for reasons that you may not totally understand with your conscious mind. And, you know, I think that's how music transfers energy, and that's also how film can transfer energy, is kind of tracking body sensation rather than did I get all the information in there, am I, tracking it for, is the vibe still there, you know, is the through line of the vibe still happening, oh, it's still happening, oh, this story works that way, and now you start to see, you know, you re-examine something like that, and you start to see the way it connects to itself, and it's in a form that's more complex than one you could will into existence by design, because it is operating on that level of the kind of inner morphology of body sensation. And that's kind of what I'm interested in, is like, I don't think that's separate from narrative. I actually think that the way music works is it's accessing these deeper patterns and structures in our body, mind, and the reason why one piece of music can make you feel deeply sad or joyful in different times is because those deep body morphologies, subatomic or cellular morphologies, the difference between joy and sadness is very small, you know. And I think I wanted the movie to work that way, to kind of operate on those deeper subconscious levels at the same time, rather than just be a delivery service for information that you could find online.
Well, that said, I can see why you would retire to you.